I'm sorry, I have to apologize at the start. I love you guys and everything, but I'm definitely going to fuck up pronunciations of everything. So feel free to correct me whenever you need to, you know. No problem. So Ina, is that right?
Yep.
Oh, good. I got one right. Perfect. Okay.
Cool.
Good start.
Yeah, that's it. Cool. All right. Look, Ina, we're speaking today on the day of the double album release of Vit Raven, the album that came out a year ago. Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah. So we'll get to that eventually, but if it's cool, I wouldn't mind going back to, 2003 to start with, like, yourself and Gala, you know, in Gorgoroth, and then you leave that and Wardruna begins. What was the first sort of inspiration to start Wardruna?
Well, it's kind of an interest and that I've had since child. My interest for history, Old Norse traditions and culture and so on. So that Wardruna was an idea, a vision that had been brewing for a few years, and at that time, early 2000s, and I was kind of, on a personal level, I was kind of done with the whole metal thing. I had the need to do something that was closer to my heart, and my own personal passion and interest was kind of became stronger and stronger, and at the same time there weren't really any projects that was portraying the old culture like on its own terms, you know. There was a lot of projects that had small elements of it that you find in metal music as well, you know, both melodically, maybe an instrument here and there, and of course a lot in the imagery and lyrics. But here my vision was more about going a bit further and using relevant instrumentation, sounds, language, recording relevant conditions or places. The list goes on, so I guess it was the decision to start something, start over again, and do Wardruna was kind of born out of both a personal need, but also a void of there being such a project, I guess.
Oh, that's cool, man. That's the best reason to do something, you know. And if that's not there, you do it, right? That's good.
Yeah,
cool. So yeah, the first the debut album, it's the first of the Runeljord, am I saying that right? Runeljord?
Yeah, Runeljord.
Runeljord, okay, Jord, gotcha. Runeljord, right. When you started writing those songs, were you always like anticipating, okay, we're going to do three albums with this specific Elder Futhark in the Norse Runes thing going on?
Well, in the beginning, there were several ideas. That was on the table, one of them being the runes that was there from the start. And as soon as I decided on doing the runes, doing it as a trilogy became kind of apparent and logical. So separating the 24 into 3/8 tracked albums. And yeah, so I guess doing the first album took me 7 years to complete, and was a lot of research and instrument building finding that balance and finding the recipe, basically. Took a lot of time. The complete circle took me 15 years to complete. So doing a trilogy was, I wouldn't say regretted, but it was an intense project to or process to work on one project that was so much, where basically the whole concept was laid, 15 years ago. So working on one project for such a long time, that it was pretty intense, and it felt good to be done with it as well, because there was a lot of ideas for other things that had just been put in a drawer for that long time period. So
you said talked about building instruments. Is that because you can't buy traditional instruments, you have to make your own? Is that the idea?
Well, a lot of traditional instruments you can use, but many of the instruments that I decided I wanted to have in this project are basically historical instruments that we don't use in the traditional music anymore, because it's much older. So the only place you would find them at the time would be in a museum or on a drawing or something like that. These days, the interest for this part of the culture and for these instruments has just exploded. So now it's much easier to get hold of them. But at that time, 20 years ago, it was only like a handful of people who were working with them, and even fewer people building them. So in some cases, I had to have people build them for me, and other cases I built them myself. It was a long process of lots of trial and error. Made quite a few shitty instruments along the way, and but working with some of these instruments is very much a learning process, and still is, I would say.
What would you say was one of the harder ones to get right?
Define get right. You
know? be happy with, I guess.
Yeah.
Some instruments we have a living tradition of using that goes many thousand years back, and of course they are more established in what we know about them, how they were used and how they are used, and of course there are instruments that are more open for interpretation, and like the string instrument, that's more murky territory in terms of how people might have done it like 1,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago. We don't know. So then it comes down to other sets of logics and a lot of trial and error. I don't know. Naming one specific instrument as the hardest one, I don't know. That's a little bit difficult.
Yeah, that's cool. 2014, your music becomes part of Vikings. That's, you know, a massive audience for you. How did that come about?
Well, it was basically the way I've been told from them and from the main composer of the show was that they were actually struggling a lot with the first season, finding the right musical balance, and then one of the producers came across Wadruna, they basically decided to that they liked it, of course, and that they wanted to have it part of the show. So they licensed, maybe I think for the first season it was 7 or 8 songs, after that, they got in touch again and asked me if I wanted to become more involved, also with the soundtrack itself. Decided to give it a go and ended up working together with Trevor Morris, who is the main composer of the show. Worked with him on a few seasons, but alongside that, they were also using a lot of the Wodruna music. I think there are over 50 or 60 placements of Wodruna music throughout the seasons. So it's quite a bit. And on top of that, I also worked quite a bit directly with the production. Also when things like, whenever actors were singing, or it could be battle cries, you know, drunken songs, funeral songs, then I wrote it for them. And there is one of these songs I've seen on the internet. A lot of people have and other artists have been making their own versions of this song. My Mother Told Me, it's called, or Thus Spoke My Mother, which is a song I wrote based on an old old Norse poem. So yeah, it's been a fun project to be part of, happy to be given the chance to show our music to such a huge amount of people. That's it's a cool thing.
Yeah, of course. And you also featured on the show. How was that? I mean, your music videos look amazing and everything, but I imagine the Viking production is a lot larger, maybe.
you can say that. Yeah, I was in front of camera performing on two occasions, it was an interesting experience, a positive one, I have to say. Fun.
Is that something you'd be interested in, you know, pursuing a bit further, like being in front of the camera?
Nah. Or, you know, if the right opportunity or something interesting would come along, I'd of course consider it, but it's not something I'm going to pursue.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? I'll stick to my thing who knows what happens.
Yeah, cool. That's cool. 2016, a piece for Mind and Mirror, the collaboration with, again, I'm going to say this name wrong, probably, Ivar Bjornsson.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Okay, thanks. Yeah. I love his Slave, the great band. It's such a cool piece of music. Like, is there any chance the two of you will work together again?
I would say that's pretty likely. We did the Skug Show piece for Mind and Mirror, and then we did the Hook Show album, I don't know. We enjoy working together, and I'm pretty sure that when our both our calendars align perfectly, we're definitely gonna do something else together in the future, definitely.
Do you think it'll be the same vein, kind of like History of Norway, kind of that kind of thing still?
Yeah, definitely. I definitely think we're gonna build on what we've always been doing. You know, even though we are conceptually, we're kind of working with a lot of the same ideas and material, but our approach is very different, of course, musically, but also conceptually. And that combination, I think, is very very interesting. I think, you know, Skug Show, the first thing we did together, that was like when we were asked to do that, it was like more of a prefix in terms of what it was going to be. The commission was kind of Enslaved meets Wodruna. Whereas the second time we ended up working together on the Skug Show, we kind of based on that experience, chose a little bit of a different direction where we wanted to go more into the acoustic landscape and do it with a little less people involved, basically. And I'm sure in the next chapter, whatever we end up doing, we're going to continue to build, and whether it's expansion or who knows, there are so many possibilities, and Eva is such a creative guy as well. It's a pleasure to work with him.
Oh, great, that's cool. So you've done some video game soundtracks, Assassin's Creed Valhalla, and the theme for Volley Bear in League of Legends. How's your approach when you're writing things for the screen rather than for a record? Like, do you think it's a different approach, or is it pretty similar?
It's pretty different, I have to say. The format is different, so you have to approach it differently as well. And of course, you know, also the difference between when I worked with Vikings, I sit with the footage in front of me, and you have to sort of adapt and adjust where to take place and where to give space, in a way. Whereas my work on Assassin's Creed, we were three composers on the game, and the two other, they could focus mostly on like the more classical video game soundtrack, whereas my work on Assassin's Creed were more song based, and created music for special missions and so on, both like fully produced more like in the Wodruna soundscape, but also, and perhaps mostly, it was songs that were created in as like completely acoustic, very stripped down and naked songs, basically, voice and one instrument. The creators of the game, they wanted to do a thing that one of the reasons why I was so excited about doing that, working on that game, was that they wanted to give space to a tradition which is very often neglected whenever Old Norse culture is portrayed, and that is the skaldic tradition, the poetic tradition, which was such a big part of the old oral society and the old Nordic culture. It was such a prestigious and complicated art form. So the fact that they wanted to give that tradition such a big focus and give voice to that tradition, that was such a cool thing to be part of. I kind of felt important in a way to give voice to that very often neglected part of our old culture.
Yeah, that's cool. Are you a gamer at all, or are you just writing the music? No.
I don't have time to do gaming, but I do enjoy it, and I used to, when I had more time in my younger days, I did play video games, and the fun thing with when I my first homework when I got involved in the Assassin's Creed was actually you need to play at least between 20 and 30 hours of Assassin's Creed. so they sent me one of the older versions, so I could sit there and say that is working.
Yeah, that's good.
So that was fun and of course necessary, so you see how things work, how it is built up, and also to see the potential of how things can be done. So it was cool. Of course necessary.
Yeah, no, that's great. I wish someone would give me that kind of homework, but no.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe someday.
Yeah, maybe. So 2015, Gal, one of the you know, founding members, leaves Wardrina. Has that changed the band dynamics much, having him away from it?
Yeah, we sort of parted way on amicable terms. Yeah. There was no problem. We've been close friends for such a long time and still are, you know. So that was kind of a door that was open both ways from the get-go, you know. Mm. If it feels right, then fine. If not, also fine. Well, of course, it changed it, at the same time, it wasn't like something we focused that much on, you know. We've just continued to look forward, of course. I think his most important part, at least for certain periods, and in the beginning of the project, he was kind of my person that I would throw my ideas at, since we have a lot of the same interest and a great passion for that side of culture, it was really good to have him in establishing the sort of framework to throw ideas back and forth and concepts and so on. And of course, live, he's a force of nature in a way, and he's very good at becoming one with whatever it is he's expressing. It was great to have him in the period we did have him aboard, but afterwards we kind of haven't looked back, so yeah. It was totally fine and unproblematic.
No, good. So if we jump forward a bit to the fourth album, it was a live in studio recording. That sounds like a different process. How'd you go about, you know, making that happen? Was that tricky to kind of get the sound right, or, you know?
Well, we didn't do it with the intention of it becoming a release. We decided to, yeah, when the pandemic hit, we had to postpone the album. So we did that for 6 months or so, a bit more. And then we saw that, well, the pandemic just continued, and performing live in front of an audience would not be possible. So we decided we wanted some form of release concert. And so we... But at the same time, we didn't want to do it just... get on top of a stage and do whatever we do when we're in front of an audience. We wanted to play a bit more with the format, there is a different set of opportunities, of course, in that format than in a live concert. So why not sort of exploit that? So it was just intended for a live streaming event, basically. A multi-camera recording in a studio space, I don't know. In afterwards, we were really happy with the result, with how it sounded, and the energy was there. Most importantly, there was a good friction in the air. We hadn't been in the same room for over a year, I don't know, that energy, I think we were lucky enough and able to capture that. And so afterwards we decided we wanted to look into maybe releasing it, both as a DVD and as a live in studio album.
Yeah, it's cool. Talking about, you know, being with other musicians, was it hard to source musicians originally who played traditional albums? Like, where do you look for those kind of people? You know what I mean?
Yeah, where do you look for them? No, back, well, in the beginning, that was, you sort of had to, well, a lot of the instruments I played myself. So I did many, many different instruments. Then I had, like, well, within the traditional music scene, there were, I had people who were, they were able to learn how to play the bowed instruments and so on. So, and then, yeah, within the percussion, but it's been a slow process, basically, that also, evolving. There's been quite a few different musicians involved along, yeah, during this time. And but yeah, no, recruiting was that wasn't an easy task, but it probably helped that I was basically doing a lot of the strangest instruments myself.
Yeah. And there's a lot of soundscape in your music, you know, trees and wind and things. Are you doing field recordings or are you sourcing them somewhere else?
No, I try to do all of that myself. So most of them are field recordings. Some of well, the creative concept of Vårdruna is basically that it is the themes themselves that, that define the instrumental needs, where I record, when I record, the sounds I use, the language I use, and so on. So some of these field recordings or some of the vocals or instruments are actually recorded outdoors or in a space that has relevance to whatever the song is about. Also, like, yeah, playing on fire and trees and stones and water and so on. So anything and everything to get us to bring it closer to whatever it is I'm trying to convey.
It's cool. It's definitely like it's visceral, you know, like you can feel it. I think it's an effective way to do it, you know. Yeah,
I definitely believe it. You know, I could probably chop off a table leg and get the same sound as a birch tree, but, you know, added value is added value. I'm 100% sure that the listener, whether it's consciously or subconsciously, will know the difference. So yeah, added value is added value.
Yeah, for sure. How are things with the COVID situation in Norway? Like, is Vårdruna able to play in front of an audience again?
Yeah. We there are basically no restrictions or anything anymore. We were finally able to do concerts again now. Like, we had a Norwegian tour that was moved two times.
Okay.
So third time lucky. And we've also done we recently did a show in Iceland, and we did a tour in England, Scotland, Ireland, and France earlier. So things are slowly coming back to normal, or some form of normal.
Yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, cool. And what's next for Vårdruna? Are you do you have another theme in mind or something that you want to do with the next record?
Yes, I do. But I can, if I tell you, I have to kill you afterwards.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, at this point, you know, we have so much concerts that we've been juggling around now for this whole pandemic period. So the main focus is to get that done, as much of it as possible, and then then I'll start focusing on new music again.
Yeah, no, that's cool. Awesome. Well, look, Anna, thanks very much for your time. Much appreciated. I'm looking forward to, checking out the album that comes out today. The footage looks amazing with all the, you know, the mist and the lights. Everything is very cool. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, cool. Thanks a lot.
All right. Bye-bye. Have a good day.
You too, man. See ya.